You broke them down, and there were chains around us. By your grace, we are no longer bound, no longer bound. You called me out of the grave, you called me into the light. You called my name, and then my heart came alive.
Yeah. Good morning. Good morning. My name is Ben Clements. If you're just making your way in, please come through the foyer, take a seat. It's slightly warmer in this space than in the foyer. Well, my name is Ben Clements. I'm an associate minister here at St. Alfred's. Well, welcome to our service today. Now, whether you are visiting us here for the first time, whether you are here for the 100th time, or 40 years, who knows? Whoever you are, wherever you've come from, whether you're watching us online, welcome. It is so great to have you in the Lord's house today. If I haven't met you yet, I'd love to have a chance to chat over morning tea. Please stick around and say hello. Say hello to anyone that you've seen up here on the platform today. Our children are staying in today during the school holidays. So if you do have children, please make sure you let them grab a couple of colouring and activity packs on their way in. And we have a sermon bingo again happening. Now, I was actually talking to someone who wasn't quite in that child demographic, who still took one to kind of test the memory. So look, I mean, if that's going to help you pay attention to what Renee has to say, then by all means, do help yourself as well. Well, earlier this week, I was meeting with some other Anglican ministers, and we were reflecting on our experiences in church ministry. And as we were doing that, we reminded ourselves and reaffirmed to ourselves that as we gather together in worship, you see, Sundays are not simply an opportunity to encourage one another in fellowship, even though that certainly happens. Sundays aren't simply an opportunity to learn more about God, even though we do. Sundays are a place where we encounter God together. And so as I was preparing for our Sunday service today, the words that God really laid on my heart, like he woke me up in the middle of the night with these words, it was, draw near to me. Draw near to me. So my brothers and sisters, God wants us to draw near to him today. And I love it that one of the opening greetings in our prayer book, it says, friends in Christ, we come together to meet with God. So there's an expectation that as we gather, God is here amongst us. And I love these words from the book of Hebrews. I'll be up on the screen. It says, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, and since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and with the full assurance that faith brings. Jesus is able to save completely those who draw near to God through him, because he always lives to intercede for them. So I've been praying this week that as we hear and respond to what God says in his word, as we lift up our hearts in thanks and praise for what he has done, as the Holy Spirit ministers in and through us, as we gather around the Lord's table, that you and I would draw near to God and encounter him together. And I believe there are some of you here that particularly need to hear that invitation today. And if that's you, then God wants you to know the freedom that you have to be here, to draw near to God through the risen Jesus, and you can have confidence to be in his presence today. And so I do invite you to please stand as you are able. Please join me in praying these words in bold as we draw near to God today. Let's pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please remain standing as we sing.
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, it trembles at his feet.
We are going to do a kid's song next. So if you are a kid here, we're going to keep singing about how great God is. And just like Ben said, we want to draw near to God today. Now, I'm going to ask you to come up to the front, not because God is nearer at the front, but because the music is louder at the front. And sometimes that can be lots of fun. So if you're a kid, or if you feel like a kid today, and you want to come have a little bounce around here in the front, come on up, kids, and including my kids, come on up. and we're going to sing about how great and big our God is, and how he's bigger than skyscrapers, and wider than submarines, and lots of exciting things. So let's go.
Thank you to our band. Now, kids, you can stay up the front here. It's great that you're already up the front. I was wondering if you know anyone famous?
Jesus,
excellent answer. Well, this is a picture of my sister Anne-Marie, and she knows Colin Buchanan. And she used to be the props girl on his music videos. And she sometimes even had a cameo. So this is from a music video of Colin's. And it was a memory verse of James 4 verse Seville. Do you know that one? It had to rhyme with devil, so they made it Seville instead of seven. Anyway, she was the burger girl. Anyway, I was thinking, she knows Colin Buchanan. In our story today, there was a mother of two who had two sons. And I thought, I wonder who's a mother of two sons. I've got two sons. And I was thinking, if they wanted to become children's music entertainers, maybe I could go up to Colin and say, you know my sister Anne-Marie, and I have two sons, one who plays the violin and one who plays the trombone. Could they be in your next music video and you could put one on your right-hand side and one on your left-hand side? What do you think? What do you think Colin would say? He might say, go away, strange lady. Or he might say yes, or he might say no, who knows. But that's probably not the way to try and get your children into a Christian music video. In our story today, a true story that's about Jesus, another mother came up to Jesus, and she had two sons, and she said to Jesus, can you put one on your right-hand side and one on your left-hand side when you start your new kingdom, when you're in charge and you're the big boss? I want one of my children to be the second most important after you and the other child to be the third most important in your new kingdom. Because she was putting in a good word for her sons, James and John, who were two of the disciples. The rest of the disciples heard this and they were outraged, probably because they thought they should have thought of that to ask Jesus, but this mum had thought of it instead. And Jesus, I think, thought, wow, this lady does not understand my kingdom. Because in my kingdom, it's not about being the most important and having the most power. In my kingdom, what's most important is being a servant. So I thought I'd read you the exact bit so I don't get it wrong. He said, you know the rulers around here, they lord it over the people and their high officials exercise authority over them. Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to be great amongst you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first must be your slave. Just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. So this is the Jesus who was about to wash his disciples' feet, and this is the Jesus who loved everyone so much and came to serve them so he would die on a cross to save their sins. Now, I was thinking about some of the ministers at our church, and I was thinking lots of them are good examples of being servants, but I thought I might not embarrass them by telling you a story about them. So I thought I would tell you about my friend Nigel. Now my clicker's not working. Oh, that's not a good idea. Anyway, there was a picture that was going to be there of Nigel, but that's okay. He was my here we go. That's Nigel. He was my first boss when I finished theological college, and he was a minister, and we worked at a little church that was doing some church planting, and it was pretty exciting. And Nigel was an excellent preacher, and he was a good leader. But do you know what? I didn't know this until he went on holidays and he told me the things that we needed to do on a Sunday to make sure that everything worked. And I did not know that after everyone had gone home at the end of the day, because I should say it was one of these old churches and they rented out their halls for a kinder during the week. And so we had church late on a Sunday night and then the next morning all the kids were going to come. And someone had to clean the toilets, of course, before the kinder came. And no one really knew that it was Nigel who stayed behind every week to clean the toilets so that it would be ready and fresh for the kinder kids when they came. And it was only really because he went on holidays that I found out that he did that every week. Isn't that a great example of being a servant? And not just, because he probably could have made a roster and signed up everyone else to have to clean the toilets, you know, once a week. But instead, he just did it. And so when we're looking for a new vicar of our church, we don't want someone who is just a great preacher, although I think we'll all be relieved if they are. But we also want someone who's going to be a servant, like our Peter has already, but we want someone who's going to be a servant as well. How about I pray for us, and then you can listen a bit more during the sermon because Renee's going to talk about some of the same things and you can do your sermon bingo. Dear Father, we thank you that we are all a church family together, praising you and learning about you together. We thank you for our precious kids and that they are part of your family. And so we pray as we continue in our service together that you'd help us to enjoy being family together in this service, enjoy learning together, and enjoy being part of each other's lives. And we pray that when we look at our leaders at this church, that they will continue to be great servants. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, well, it's time for the notices, so you guys can go back to your seats. Welcome everyone to church. It's great to have you. I'm one of the ministers here, the Children's and Families Minister, and my name is Louisa. I've got a few announcements to give, and so the first one is for a women's conference that I help run. We're going to show a video, and then I'll just say a few things.
In a world where good leaders are rare, our anxiety has us crying out for justice, for relief, for comfort, for certainty. In the midst of chaos, where and how does God lead his people? At Entrust this year, we embark on a brand new series through the book of Judges and Ruth. Side by side in the Bible, these two books confront our chaos with God's kindness. In 2024, our speakers Heather Reed and Britt Chiganani will be looking at Judges Ehud and Deborah and explore the unshakable truths about our human condition and God's response to injustice. This year, Entrust will again be in person at New Hope Baptist Church. We are also pleased to offer a streaming option again this year. So join us on the 4th of May as we look at the book of Judges, Our Chaos, God's Kindness. We can't wait to see you there.
Okay, so it's coming up in 3 weeks, and the early bird ticket prices finish this Friday. So it'd be lovely, ladies, if you wanted to come along, learn about the Book of Judges. It's a rollickingly, well, not good, but interesting book to read. And our own Amy Just will be doing one of the seminars in the what do we do with God's violence, particularly against women in the Old Testament. So that is going to be a great time, I'm sure. We also have an announcement about going bananas.
Stephen Bradbury. You know him, you love him. He has revived his speed skating career and is willing to make a comeback for Going Bananas 2024. But the question we're all asking, can he lead? He has checked his calendar and is available for training on Saturday mornings in June. He's put a notification on for doing day. He won't stumble on the fact that GB is late this year. He's booked out the 8th to the 12th of July in his diary. He's gone online and filled out the GB 2024 leader application form. He's checked in with Pam at the office, and his child safe training is up to date. The crowd goes wild. He can lead. Make sure you don't miss out. Going Bananas leadership registration is live now. Join us for our Olympics extravaganza in the Gospel of Mark. See you soon.
So we're doing an Olympics theme this year for GB, which I think is going to be a lot of fun. But it's time for us to ask for people to apply to volunteer or be a leader. And even if you're going to be a volunteer, please fill out the leader/volunteer form online. The form online is not just for the program team leaders, but it's for everyone who volunteers so that we can get the process started. We'd love to have you involved. Thanks very much.
A couple more things that are coming up. We have a men's event on the horizon on May the 4th. Rather fittingly, it's known as Star Wars Day, and we're speaking about life, the universe, and everything. We have our very own Selvi Rosso, who's going to be sharing about his experience, and that's really looking forward to that. If you are a male, and teens are welcome as well, make sure you're accompanied by an adult as well. That's going to be a great event. Please make sure you register on the website. You can follow that QR code, and all the details are on there as well. There are also some flyers in the foyer. Make sure you pick them up. We have some events coming up in the next month for Peter's farewell. There's so many different things that Peter is involved with, and so here are some of the ways that we can help him to finish well in these different ministries. So we've got our Wednesday congregation on the 1st of May having their final one, and Peter is going to be there. Then we have St. Luke's. That is a Sunday before his final one here. He's having a farewell over there. We are having a church-wide dinner, which I'll tell you a bit more about in a second. And then on the Sunday, the 19th, his final two services, where there'll be some chances to farewell him well in that. Now, back to the celebration dinner. There's another slide about that one. So there are some postcards out there if you want some more information about it, and you can register online right now. But basically, so it's Saturday the 18th of May, and it's an evening from 6 p.m. It's right here, and depending on the numbers, we might kind of end up growing to fill the entire church facility. It's $40 per person, and that does include a two-course meal. Pretty sure, yes. Two-course meal. Make sure you do register on the events page, and that one that is registering. And we've already had close to 80 people register already, so make sure you get onto that. Things are closing fast there. Please do BYO your own drinks. There will be some non-alcoholic things available as well. Now, this dinner is for adults, and the registration will end midnight on the 5th of May, so we can make sure that all of the catering and all the layout stuff is all under control. And so we can't accept any late regos. So if you would like to come along, please make sure you get onto that today or as soon as you can. Well, Louisa mentioned that Renee is going to be preaching to us in a little bit. He's still on his way from St. Luke's, so let's pray that he gets here safely. He's going to be preaching to us from 2 Corinthians chapter 10, continuing our costly leadership series that we are in now. And what we will find is that Paul is facing criticism for his leadership. In particular, we find that the people, they're wanting a leader who looked and sounded a particular way. You know, who ticked all the right boxes, who was impressive, who was inspiring. And Paul, well, he was a disappointment to them. For Paul, he knew that he modeled himself actually after the person of Jesus. And Jesus, he was someone who showed true strength in his humility and his gentleness. We saw that in our kids' talk with Louisa before. He came as a servant. He humbled himself. And so for Jesus, true strength is humility and gentleness. And so then Paul, he challenged the Corinthians for then judging by their appearances, for living by the standards of the world, rather than aligning their inner thoughts and outward actions to what Jesus wanted. So as we prepare to share communion in a moment together, let us spend a moment in silence, reflecting on the times, particularly this week, when maybe we have been like the Corinthians. Those times this week where we have judged others by appearances rather than their heart. Those times where we have lived by the standards of the world rather than what Jesus calls us to. Times when we have thought too highly of ourselves rather than acting in gentleness, humility, and love. After a moment of reflection, we will say the prayer of confession together. Let us draw near to God with sincerity and confidence and pray together. God of all mercy, we humbly admit that we need your help. We have wandered from your way. We have sinned in thought, word, and deed and have failed to do what is right. You alone can save us. Have mercy on us. Wipe out our sins and teach us to forgive others. Bring forth in us the fruit of your Spirit, that we may live the new life to your glory. This we ask in the name of Jesus, our Saviour. Amen. Well, my brothers and sisters, God desires that none should perish, but that all should turn to Christ and live. In response to his call, we have acknowledged our sins. God pardons those who humbly repent and truly believe the gospel. Therefore, we have peace with God through Jesus Christ. Amen. Hear these words again from Hebrews 7. Jesus is able to save completely those who draw near to God through him, because he always lives to intercede for them. I invite you to stand as you are able. Well, we are the body of Christ. His Spirit is with us. The peace of the Lord be always with you, and also with you. Please take a moment to share that peace with one another.
If you'd like to return but stay up standing, please remain standing but return to your seats, if you know what I mean. We're coming now. Our order of service is a little bit unusual because of waiting for Renee to arrive, so we're going to celebrate communion together now. If you would join me in saying the words on screen that come up in bold. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Loving God, we thank you for this world of wonder and delight. You have given it to us to care for so that all your creatures may enjoy its bounty. Lord our God, we give you thanks and praise. We thank you that when we turned away from you, you sent Jesus to live and work as one of us and bring us back to you. He showed us how to love you and set us free to love and serve one another. Lord our God, we give you thanks and praise. We thank you that on the cross Jesus took away our sin, all that keeps us from each other and from you. He frees us from hate and fear, from all that destroys love and trust. Lord our God, we give you thanks and praise. And so with everyone who believes in you, with all the saints and angels, we rejoice and praise you, saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Together. And now we thank you for these gifts of bread and wine. May we who receive them, as Jesus said, share his body and his blood. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke the bread and gave it to his friends and said, Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. After supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He shared the cup with them and said, This is my blood poured out so that sins may be forgiven. Do this in remembrance of me. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. You have gathered us together to feed on Christ and to remember all he has done for us. Fill us with your Spirit that we may follow Jesus in all we do and say, working for justice and bringing your peace to this world that you have made. Accept our prayers through Jesus Christ, our Lord. blessing and honor and glory and power are yours forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated, and could I invite the communion assistants to come forward. If you're visiting us today, you're very welcome to join us at communion. If you're a follower of Jesus, please join us in taking the wafers and the non-alcoholic juice, or a gluten-free wafer if that's your preference. The central seats come down the central aisle and come to the front, and the side seats go out to the foyer to receive communion. And we leave it to parents to decide if children are ready to receive communion or to receive a blessing. Auditorium, foyer. So come, let us take this sacrament of the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ in remembrance that he died for us, and feed on him in our hearts by faith and with thanksgiving.
Thank you.
Please stand with us and sing.
There is a truth older than the ages. There is a promise of things yet to come. There is
He carries my healing in him.
God, we thank you for the presence of Jesus who is with us today. We thank you for his blood that has taken away our sins. Jesus, we thank you for everything that you've done for us. And it's in your name that we pray. Amen. Please be seated.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for the joy and the privilege it is to gather as your people and pray together. We pray as in Hebrews 10:22, to draw near to you with true hearts in full assurance of faith. And as we draw near to you, you draw near to us. We ask by your Holy Spirit to experience your loving heart this morning in beautiful ways. And I invite us all to pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Thank you, Lord, for the world that you gave us to live in, for homes, families, food, friends, school, work, medical care, and so much more. How blessed we are. I ask every one of us to spend a few moments to remember and give thanks in our hearts or out loud for all we are so glad to have. I give God thanks for all of you, our church family. We bring you, Lord, for those who have so little or nothing, and ask you to give them a safe place to live, food to eat, family and friends to care for and be cared for by them. We ask you to bring peace to places where wars are going on, and for forgiveness, healing, cooperation, and friendship amongst all your people. And at this moment, Lord, we lift up all those caught up in the trauma of the events in Sydney last night. Hold them close, Lord. Bring healing and peace from the grief and the trauma that is so profound amongst them at this time. Thank you, Father, for all our missionaries, for those we send out, and every one of us where we are at, in our homes, schools, communities, and workplaces. We pray for Lauren Weatherlake and praise God for the 20 students who went to Swinburne Base Camp recently, and ask you to keep blessing the continued building of relationships with each other and with yourself. We pray also that the gospel message attached to the 200 hot cross buns that were given out be heard and received, and ask that the hunger for your gospel grow way bigger than that for the hot cross buns. We pray, Lord, for the approval of Lauren's application for chaplaincy to help with access to the faith space on campus. We pray, Lord, for us all to take a moment to pray for all the campus students and those that we know personally who don't know Jesus to come and accept Jesus as their Lord and Saviour. We pray for them to receive the loving blessings of life in knowing him. Would you just spend a few moments to bring these ones silently to your heart or out loud as you feel led? We pray for all those that are unwell in our community and our church, and ask for peace and healing of bodies, minds, and spirits for each one. Thank you for St. Alfred's and everyone in your church, Lord. We ask you to bless your church in every way. Help us all to generously love others, to be able to forgive self and others, to speak truth, stay kind always, value others, and be thankful for the different gifts in all of us, that we use those gifts for your glory. Our church needs every one of them and all of us. We ask for your continued blessing on the team that is searching for the new minister. We ask and thank you for the godly wisdom, humility, strength, faithfulness in the one you have chosen for the time here. We give you thanks for the seasons that we have had. We thank you, Lord, for the joy of every child and youth here at St. Alfred's, and grow their faith and their outreach that shares and invites others into the family of God. Thank you, Lord, for their example to us all to have the childlike faith that you delight in. We offer all this to you, dear Lord, for your glory, for love's sake. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Today's reading is taken from 2 Corinthians chapter 10, beginning at the first verse. Paul's defence of his ministry. By the humility and gentleness of Christ, I appeal to you. I, Paul, who am timid when face to face with you, but bold toward you when away. I beg that when I come, I may not have to be as bold as I expect to be towards some people who think we live by the standards of this world. For though we live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. The weapons we fight with are not the weapons of the world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds. We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God. And we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. And we will be ready to punish every act of disobedience once your obedience is complete. You are judging by appearances. If anyone is confident they belong to Christ, they should consider again that we belong to Christ just as much as they do. So even if I boast somewhat freely about the authority the Lord gave us for building you up rather than tearing you down, I will not be ashamed of it. I do not want to seem to be trying to frighten you with my letters. For some say, his letters are weighty and forceful, but in person he is unimpressive and his speaking amounts to nothing. Such people should realise that we are in our letters when we are absent, we will be in our actions when we are present. We do not dare to classify or compare ourselves with some who commend themselves. When they measure themselves by themselves and compare themselves with themselves, they're not wise. We, however, will not boast beyond proper limits, but will confine our boasting to the sphere of service God Himself has assigned to us, a sphere that also includes you. We are not going too far in our boasting, as would be the case if we had not come to you, for we did get as far as you with the gospel of Christ. Neither do we go beyond our limits by boasting of work done by others. Our hope is that as your faith continues to grow, our sphere of activity among you will greatly expand, so that we can preach the gospel in the regions beyond you. For we do not want to boast about work already done in somebody else's territory. But let the one who boasts boast in the Lord. For it is not the one who commends himself who is approved, but the one whom the Lord commends. This is the word of Christ.
Good morning, everyone. I've made it over here from St. Luke's in one piece, so thank you for your prayers. I'm going to put a statement to you, see if you agree with this. No one likes to be criticised. Does that sound about right? Being criticised isn't fun. Well, that is if you're a person with normal amounts of empathy. Well, why is that? Well, criticism can make us feel like we're failing. It can make us feel like we're not measuring up to other people's standards. It can make us feel like we're under scrutiny. I don't enjoy being criticised, speaking for myself. I don't especially enjoy hearing about how I don't measure up to other people's expectations. Now, criticism can happen in the workplace. Here's someone getting some criticism for their work. Criticism can also come from your family. It can come from friends. And very occasionally, it can come from people online. Now, going back a few years now, I was a student minister. I was studying for my theological degree, and I was working in a church doing some occasional preaching and service leading. And after one particular Sunday, the senior minister had got a meeting with me, and he sat down and he gave me some feedback on my service leading. And at the end of it, he said, "Renee, I've got to be honest. I just don't think you have gifts for upfront leadership." And that was a bit of a shock for me, because I was studying to become a church minister, and there's a bit of upfront stuff involved with that role. So that wasn't particularly nice to hear. What does this say about my future? Should I even bother to continue with my studies? These were the questions turning around in my head while he was giving me that feedback. But at any rate, didn't stop me, and here I am today. But this particular minister, he gave me feedback, and the way that he gave it, it didn't feel like an attack, because it was very gentle, it didn't feel personal, and it definitely didn't feel like an attack. Well, what's the difference, though, between criticism and attack? Well, I think it's one of those things where you know it when you see it. With an attack, the person is just being plain nasty towards you. They're attributing bad motives to you. They assume you're doing the wrong things for the wrong reasons, that you're deliberately making a mess of things to the harm of others. They think you're a bad fit, and they want you to know it. And that's the kind of attack that Paul was receiving from the Corinthians. And today we return to the letter, 2 Corinthians, and here in this chapter, Paul addresses the criticism that he's faced from certain people while he's been away from Corinth. They're being very critical of Paul because he doesn't fit their mold of what a leader should be like. They think a good leader should be strong, demanding, willful, and proud. A good leader, in their opinion, would demand their right to be paid, which Paul didn't. A good leader would be great at classical rhetoric and be a powerful speaker, which Paul wasn't. A good leader would be more forceful than Paul is when it comes to discipline in the church and straightening out those who have gone wayward. A good leader would flaunt their education, their pedigree, status, and reputation, which Paul didn't. In fact, Paul operated from a different stance, which the Corinthians found pitiful. So in this chapter, we come back to Paul's defence of himself and his ministry. He's been a bit quiet on that front so far in this letter. But he comes back to this topic because there's a lot at stake here. Because with church life, with belonging to the body of Christ, it's much more than just knowing the right things to believe and the right doctrine. As important as all of that is, the way you conduct yourself in the community of believers is just as important. The way a leader conducts themselves is important. Because in the end, a Christian leader is walking in the footsteps of Jesus. A church leader is an under-shepherd of the one shepherd, the Lord Jesus. And he was not a leader in the mold of the classical Greek orator. He wasn't a proud, boastful, commanding speaker. No, Jesus was a carpenter turned travelling teacher. He spoke Aramaic, not Greek. He didn't have credentials from any of the major institutions. He preached forbearance and humility. He spoke of the last being first and the first last. He said the poor would inherit the kingdom of God, not the proud. So sometimes it sounds like Paul is being a little too insistent on defending himself in these letters, but we have to realize there's a lot at stake here. This fledgling movement, this Christian church, is being built on the foundation of the apostles Jesus selected and sent. And if the church starts rejecting Jesus' apostles, if Christians start rejecting the mode in which Paul ministers, then it won't be long before they look on Jesus as despised and weak as well. Either that, or they forge Jesus in their own image, an image of power and success and prosperity. So what kind of leadership is Paul advocating for? What kind of qualities should we be looking for in a leader? Here's four suggestions. We'll begin with gentleness, verse 1. By the humility and gentleness of Christ, I appeal to you. I, Paul, who am timid when face to face with you, but bold towards you when away. Paul's detractors are critical because he looks timid. But actually, Paul wants them to know there's a power behind his weak presentation. He goes on to explain this using the image of siege weaponry. Verse 4. The weapons we fight with are not the weapons of the world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds. Now, if you've seen The Lord of the Rings, the second movie, Two Towers, you'll recognise this place. This is Helm's Deep. And there's one scene where the orc armies are gathered around this castle and inside are the human and elvish defenders. And you can imagine their surprise when their siege weaponry comes into play and a great big section of this wall is blown apart by gunpowder. And now they're very surprised about this because they didn't even know that kind of technology existed. So all of a sudden, all these orcs are swarming into Helm's Deep. Absolutely terrifying. But that's the, you know, the orcs of Middle Earth. Paul doesn't have gunpowder or battering rams or ladders. His weapons are not the same as the world's. It's a spiritual battle. And the tactics that worked for the Greek orators in their lecture halls, they won't work in this battle. The harsh discipline that some would exercise towards wayward believers, that's not the way Paul works. Paul's mourning over straying believers, his letters, which seem second rate when compared with his actual presence, his ministry, motivated by love, may seem weak to those who don't understand how God's power works. Because Paul's words could come to us with the power of God behind them. Back in his first letter, Paul says this in chapter 1, this famous verse, "The message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing. But to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise. The intelligence of the intelligent I will frustrate." Like the ministry of Jesus, Paul's ministry is subversive. It has the appearance of weakness, but it's powerful. And that's because God works through weak people, through jars of clay, so that God's power might be seen more clearly through the weak container. So a Christian leader will be known for their gentleness. They won't feel the need to prove themselves strong, arm their opponents, or prove themselves right. I saw a living example of this when I was on the staff of a former church. One of the church members had written to a Christian magazine complaining about the senior minister. They called him a bigot and they called him prejudiced, and they announced in print that they were leaving his church. They attacked him. Now, I thought this was really poor behaviour. Well, first of all, that the journal would publish this letter for everyone to see, and secondly, that the aggrieved person wouldn't take it up with the minister himself and have a one-to-one conversation. Especially since I knew that this pastor had the best of intentions at heart, and he would have loved to have heard this guy's side of the story. So, of course, I felt really defensive on his behalf. I was outraged. I said to him, "Have you seen this letter?" And I'll always remember his response. He wasn't upset. He wasn't annoyed. You couldn't even say he was peeved. He was so gentle. And he said, he was only sorry that he probably wouldn't have the opportunity to have that conversation with this guy one-to-one and to hear his side of the story. And that left an impact on me. I wanted to be like that. His response was so gentle. He was ministering in the meekness and gentleness of Christ. Which brings us to our second quality of a godly minister. They will have confidence in Jesus, verse 7. "You are judging by appearances. If anyone is confident that they belong to Christ, they should consider again that we belong to Christ just as much as they do." Paul can have unshakable confidence to continue the work despite his weakness, because he knows that what he does isn't based on his own strength, his ability, his talents, or his support base. The only reason he's an apostle of Jesus is because he was chosen by Jesus. And if you know Paul's biography, there was nothing about him that made him worthy of this calling. But because he is in Christ, he is confident that the work will proceed, that Jesus will use him in any way that he wants. Now, sometimes this confidence looks a little bit like arrogance. Verse 8. "For even if I boast somewhat freely about the authority the Lord gave us for building you up rather than tearing you down, I will not be ashamed of it." See, far from being arrogant about his role, he attributes it to God alone. God freely chooses us to be his people. He freely gifts us with ministry, and he freely gives us gifts for ministry. Now, that doesn't mean we're in the job for life. I don't know how long I'll be in this role as the senior associate and Essex 6 minister. I hope it's a long time, because I quite enjoy being with you people, and it's a real joy to minister among you. But I don't know when I'll be moved on or called elsewhere. And the same goes if you're the senior minister, very obviously. If you're on the prayer roster, if you're a growth group leader, a GB leader, a parish councillor, etc., etc. But while we serve in these roles, we do it leaning on Jesus' strength, not our own. So that means we're not confronted when we're criticised. We're not threatened. Our world doesn't come crashing down when somebody suggests we move on, or we feel God prompting us to move on. Because ministry is a gift, and Jesus will work in the church through his powerful message. He will use ministers who work from a stance of humble dependence on Christ. Which brings us to the third quality in a faithful minister. He or she doesn't compare themselves to others. Verse 12. "We do not dare to classify or compare ourselves with some who commend themselves. When they measure themselves by themselves and compare themselves with themselves, they are not wise." Now, you may have heard the expression, "Comparison is the thief of joy." You hear it especially in the fields of the creative arts. If someone is more talented than you in your field, be that dance or music or drama or painting, don't let that ruin it for you. And some of you will recognise Bob Ross, the television painter. He would exemplify this stance, I would say. Don't be distracted by what they're doing over there. Just focus on what you're doing. Learn to appreciate what you do and how you do it. Comparison is the thief of joy. Play to your strengths Stay in your lane. Don't compare yourself to others. And that's good advice, isn't it? Until, that is, you're in the running for an award and somebody else gets that reward. Or you're in the finals and somebody else wins the finals and now you're in second place. And that doesn't feel good, because in a competition, it's a zero-sum game. But Christian ministry isn't like that. Or at least it shouldn't be like that. But sometimes we can't help ourselves. We feel competitive. We think, well, that church down the road has a bigger, noisier youth group. Or we think, that other church gets more media attention because of their outreach initiatives. Or we look at our growth group and we think, well, if I was a more charismatic, more popular leader, then there'd be more people wanting to get into my group, like that person over there does. See, Paul doesn't compare his ministry to others because it all belongs to God. He doesn't try and take over someone else's job. He doesn't want to take credit for the work of others, because his attitude is a rising tide lifts all boats. All the different parts of the kingdom are working towards the same goal, towards God's praise and God's fame. And so that means we won't become self-focused and proud when the work is going well. And on the other hand, we won't feel depressed or embittered when things aren't going so well. Because when we tie the fruit of our work to our worth as Christians, then we become people who are living out of works and not grace. Now, this is a particular danger for dedicated full-time workers, such as missionaries, church ministers, evangelists, chaplains, because the work becomes tied to our identity. It's the thing we do every day, every week. But the same thing can happen even if you're not full-time, if you're volunteering your efforts or you're doing ministry outside of church. When we compare our work with others, we compare the gifts others have with the gifts we have. And that becomes a trap. As Tracy mentioned in the prayers, the parish nominations committee are looking for a new senior minister. That's not news to most of you. What kind of minister are they looking for? Is it someone who looks and sounds just like Peter McPherson? Well, I hope not. No offence, Peter, but that would just be ridiculous, because every minister has their own gifts and abilities to bring to the job. And the new person won't have all of Peter's gifts, and they'll have some gifts that Peter doesn't currently have. And this will help us with our expectations as we anticipate and welcome a new senior leader or a new youth minister when that person comes along, or even new growth group leaders or service leaders when they arise. We can't compare gifts. We can't compare ministries. If we do, the need to prove ourselves overtakes our vision and the grace of God gets pushed out. So we need to keep reminding ourselves of this gracious gift of ministry. It's not a competition, it's a gift. It's all by grace. And finally, a faithful minister doesn't have to commend themselves. Verse 18. For it is not the one who commends himself who is approved, but the one whom the Lord commends. Well, this, of course, brings us to a very important principle of Christian leadership, which is this: the leader's heart is the thing that God values most. Unfortunately, we're the opposite. We look at gifting, past success, how good looking someone is, but God looks at the heart. God sees our character. He sees our motives. And as Paul explains in 1 Corinthians 13, that famous chapter on love, even if I'm a dynamo of spiritual power and leadership and I'm bringing scores of people into the kingdom, if I'm not a person of love at heart, then I'm not really doing work that brings honour to God. What does God require of us? Love and humble service. And see, that's difficult because our world rewards different qualities. Our workplaces reward results, reputation, connections, and we're motivated by those rewards. We feel good when people praise us. It feels nice to hear words of congratulation for something you did. But Paul is willing to be misunderstood and even despised by people who hold him accountable to the wrong values. In 1 Corinthians chapter 4, he says, "This then is how you ought to regard us, as servants of Christ and as those entrusted with the mysteries God has revealed. Now, it is required that those who have been given a trust must prove faithful. I care very little if I am judged by you or by any human court. Indeed, I do not even judge myself. My conscience is clear, but that does not make me innocent. It is the Lord who judges me." Paul says, my accountability is based on different standards than the standards you Corinthians hold currently. So there we have it. Four qualities for ministry, whether you're a senior minister, a growth group leader, leading prayers in the service, or leading the kids program. And as we saw a few weeks ago, these qualities look very much like the way Jesus fulfilled his ministry. He wasn't boastful. He didn't assert his rights. He rested secure in the identity he had as the son of his heavenly Father. He did tasks that subverted the expectations that people had for leaders. He did humble, ordinary jobs like foot washing and healing alongside the more public-facing jobs like preaching. And Jesus wants his ministers to continue in the same way. I mentioned the nominations committee looking for a new senior minister. But most of us don't have that responsibility. That's for a select few. But we all have expectations around the new person. What they'll do, the kind of person they'll be. Whether those expectations are conscious or unconscious. And that will affect the way that we relate to them and serve alongside them and talk about them. The new senior minister may be the subject of our criticism from time to time. But we should ask ourselves, are they criticisms that line up with the kind of servant leader qualities that Paul demonstrated? The Corinthians looked for different values in a leader, and that was causing them to attack Paul and to undermine him. Do our expectations for leaders line up with the way Paul describes his leadership in this letter? Does the way we serve and lead and work for the kingdom line up with the way Paul describes his way of working? Because Paul's example of servant leadership came from Jesus himself. Let's keep looking to Jesus as we serve and work for his glory alone. Amen.
We're going to respond to this picture of who Jesus is by singing a new song together. It's called Jesus Strong and Kind, and it reflects really beautifully the qualities that Renee was just talking about. I want to read some of the words to you before we sing it. Jesus said that if I thirst, I should come to him. No one else can satisfy. I should come to him. For the Lord is good and faithful. He will keep us day and night. We can always run to Jesus. Jesus strong and kind. Can you stand and we'll sing this song together? While we do that, the ushers are going to bring the offering bags forward and take the offering as well. This is an opportunity for members of St. Alfred to financially support the work we do here and around the world.
No! should come to him. Jesus said, if I am weak, I should come to him. No one else can be my strength. I should
on the cross, you were reaching out to us. And we run into the presence of a good God who has done everything for us already. God, I pray that today, if there's anyone here who needs to know and be reminded again that you have created them, saved them, made them, I pray that we would feel and know that, experience it again today, that you have made us, that we are who you say that we are, that we can walk toward a gentle, strong, kind God. In Jesus' name, amen.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the sun sets free. Oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. Free at last, he has rescued.
from 1 John chapter 3. See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Well, thank you so much for being with us today. Let me pray for us. Our Father of all, we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us home. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace, and opened the gate of glory. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We whom the Spirit lights give light to the world. Together, keep us in this hope that we have grasped, so that we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name. Amen. Well, thank you so much for joining us today. If this service has raised something for you and you would like to speak to someone about it, or you would like prayer for anything at all, please come and find me or anyone else that you have seen up here today. Please also join us for morning tea and to enjoy one another's company together in this place. Well, let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, amen.
Law gave